Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Podcasting for Dummies 4th Edition by T. Morse and Chuck Tomasi. Narrated by Derek Shoales. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Limit of liability and disclaimer of warranty. The publisher and the author make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation warranties of fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales or promotional materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for every situation. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, or other professional services. If professional assistance is required, the services of a competent professional person should be sought. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. The fact that an organization or a website is referred to in this work as a citation and/or a potential source of further information does not mean that the author or the publisher endorses the information the organization or website may provide or recommendations it may make. Further, readers should be aware that internet websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Forward. Welcome to the 4th edition of Podcasting for Dummies. This book can be your stepping-off point to being part of a vibrant community of content creators who are creating every possible kind of content, often from the quiet of the inside of a closet. While anyone can create a podcast, creating a successful podcast requires showing up week after week and working to constantly improve the quality as you build your audience. No show starts perfect, but this book instructs beginners on how to get a good start while also helping old dogs like me learn new tricks. I still remember exactly where I was when I saw a real-life copy of the first edition of Podcasting for Dummies. The year was 2007. Most people still looked at me funny when I said, "I'm a podcaster." But T. Morris had recognized me by my voice and told me to come check out a book. Back then, I think that's how all of us original podcasters knew each other. We were voices that we carried around in each other's pockets as we worked to teach each other new content. Mer Lafferty's "I Should Be Writing" still leaves me feeling guilty that I'm not writing. We also emailed and Skyped, working together to define new techniques and to build up our entire community. Opening that first edition book, I felt a thrill to see my show's logo, Slacker Astronomy's logo, listed side by side with the shows I loved most, and embedded in a book that could explain to someone how to create a podcast in the exact way I would create a podcast. Back then, I was a GarageBand plus Libsyn plus WordPress kind of producer. Back in 2007, podcasting was just 3 years old, but already it felt like everything had changed, as we went from our grassroots origins to mainstream success with the introduction of iTunes Podcast Directory. Already, T and Evo were working on a new edition, this time bringing in Chuck Tomasi for added insight. Like me, Chuck was one of the early podcasters, and with his Technorama and Chuck Chat shows, he interviewed a lot of voices in podcasting and helped network us together around our craft. Across the years, as podcasting has evolved, this book has evolved too. Today, most people know what a podcast is, but creating a standout show has actually gotten harder rather than easier. That shouldn't worry you, though. You have this book, and it will introduce you to what's needed to get started. Inside, you'll find rock-solid examples of what a good show can look like. Want a science podcast? Got it. That astronomy cast show? That's me and Fraser Kane. Want a good tech show? Got those too. Need insight on production, hosting, promotion? All of it is laid out here. I'm not going to lie. I'll be reading this book to see how I can improve, because 15 years of podcasting later, there are new tools and new best practices as Spotify, our digital assistants, Hey Alexa, and so many other platforms add podcasts to their lineups. There is so much to learn, so start reading. And welcome to the podcasting community. We are so glad you're here. Dr. Pamela Gay, astronomer and co-host of Astronomy Cast. Introduction. Maybe you've been casually surfing the interwebs. Yes, that is a thing. Or perusing your newspaper when the word podcasting has popped up. Steadily, like a building wave that would make champion surfers salivate with delight, The term has popped up again and again. And your curiosity continues to peak as the word podcasting echoes in your ears and remains in the back of your mind as a riddle wrapped in an enigma, smothered in secret sauce. Well, ponder no more. Podcasting for Dummies, 4th edition, provides the answer to the question, what is podcasting? This book takes you through the always evolving technological movement encompassing the internet, digital communications, education, and entertainment. By the time you reach the end of this book, the basics will be in place to get you, your voice, and your message heard around the world. And you can even have a bit of fun along the way. About this book. Back in 2005.
So, what are you up to, T?
I'm currently making a podcast of my first novel, a swashbuckling tale that carries our heroes.
What is a podcast?
Just the word podcasting carries an air of geekiness about it. And behold, the habitual technophobes suddenly clasp their hands to their ears and run away screaming in horror, lest they confront yet another nerdy technology that has gone mainstream. Too bad. It has been a long road for podcasting, and it has taken a decade and a half for the platform to go from something nerds are doing in the basement of the science building to a punchline about people who cannot cut it in mainstream media to plot devices in Jordan Peele's reimagining of The Twilight Zone. What an evolution. The funny thing about podcasting, outside of comedy podcasts, of course, is that it isn't that hard to do. When you peel back the covers and fancy schmancy tech talk, it's a pretty simple process to make your own podcast. You just need someone pointing the way and illuminating your path. This is why we are here, to be that candle in the dark, helping you navigate a world where anyone can do anything, provided they have the tools, the drive, and the passion. You don't need to be a techno wizard or a super geek. You need no wad of tape holding your glasses together, and your shirt tail need not stick out from your fly. Anyone can do what we show you in this book. Anyone can take a thought or an opinion, make an audio file expressing that opinion, and distribute this idea worldwide. Anyone can capture the attention of a few hundred or a few thousand people around the world through MP3 players hiding in computers, loaded on smartphones, strapped around biceps, jouncing in pockets, or hooked up to car stereos. Anyone can podcast, and anyone can listen. Podcasting from recording to online hosting can be done on a variety of budgets, ranging from frugal to Fortune 500. You can podcast about literally anything, including podcasting for its own sake. As blogging gave the anonymous, the famous, the almost famous, and the used-to-be famous a voice in politics, religion, and everyday life, podcasting adds volume and tone to that voice. Podcasting is many things to many people, but at its most basic, it's a surprisingly simple and powerful technology. What it means boils down to a single person, you. This is a platform delivering your message around the world, connecting the global village in ways that the creators of the internet, RSS, and MP3 compression would probably never have dreamed. It is the unique and the hard-to-find content that can't find a place on commercial, college, or public access radio. You're about to embark on an exciting adventure into digital media distribution. And here you'll find out that podcasting is all these things and so much more. How to use this book. Podcasting for Dummies, 4th edition, should be these things to all who read it, whether straight through or by jumping around in the chapters. A user-friendly guide on how to listen to, produce, and distribute podcasts. A terrific reference for choosing the right hardware and software to put together a sharp-sounding podcast. The starting point for the person who knows nothing about audio editing, recording, creating RSS feeds, hosting blogs, or how to turn a computer into a recording studio. A handy go-to think tank for any beginning podcaster who's hungry for new ideas on what goes into a good podcast and fresh points of view. A really fun read. There will be plenty of answers here, and if you find our answers too elementary, we give you plenty of points of reference to research. We don't claim to have all the solutions, quick fixes, and resolutions to all possible podcasting queries, but we do present to you the basic building blocks and first steps for beginning a podcast. As with any For Dummies book, our responsibility is to give you the foundation on which to build. That's what we've done our level best to accomplish. Bestow upon you the enchanted stuff that makes a podcast happen. This book was written as a linear path from the conceptualization stages to the final publication of your work. However, not everyone needs the book from the very beginning. If you've already gotten your feet wet with the various aspects of podcasting, jump around from section to section and read the parts that you need. We provide plenty of guides back to other relevant chapters for when the going gets murky. Conventions used in this book. When you go through this book, there are a few symbols. There's a method to this madness, and those methods are conventions found throughout this book. When we refer to keyboard shortcuts for Macintosh or Windows, we designate them with Mac or Windows. For Mac shortcuts, we use the command key and the corresponding letter. For Windows shortcuts, we use the abbreviation for the control key, CTRL, and the corresponding letter. So the shortcut for select all looks like this. Command A, Mac. Control A, Windows. If keyboard shortcuts aren't your thing and you want to know where the commands reside in the menus, we use the command arrow to help guide you through menus and submenus. So the command for select all in the application's menu is Edit, Select All. You first select the Edit menu and then select All. Bold assumptions. We assume that you have a computer, a lot of curiosity, and a desire to podcast. We couldn't care less about whether you're using a Mac, a PC, Linux, Unix, or two Dixie cups connected with a string. Okay, maybe the two Dixie cups connected with string would be a challenge. A computer is essential. In podcasting, the operating system just makes the computer go. We are here to provide you tools for creating a podcast, regardless of what OS you're running. If you know nothing about audio production, this book can also serve as a fine primer on how to record, edit, and produce audio on your computer, as well as accessorize your computer with mixing boards, professional-grade microphones, and audio engineering software that will give you a basic understanding of this creative field. You can hang on to this book as a handy reference geared for audio in podcasting. Again, our book is a starting point, and a trusted starting point at that. With everything that goes into podcasting, there are some things this book is not now, nor will ever be about. Here's the short list. We're not out to make you into an uber geek in RSS or XML, but we give you all you need to make things work, even get you Spotify ready. We figure that if you get hold of Audacity, GarageBand, or Audition, you can take it from there, but we give you overviews of those programs and a few basic editing examples. We're not out to teach you how to get rich quick through this platform. While we teach you how to produce a podcast, there is no magic formula in making the next serial or slow burn. If you are looking for a terrific start to the podcasting experience, then, in the words of the last knight guarding the Holy Grail in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade,
you have chosen wisely.
How this book is organized. The following sections give you a quick overview of what this book has to offer. And yeah, we're going to keep the overview brief because we figure you're eager to get started. But the fact that you're reading this passage also tells us you don't want to miss a detail. So here's a quick bird's eye view of what we do in Podcasting for Dummies. Part 1. Podcasting on a Worldwide Frequency. Part 1 goes into the bare-bones basics of how a podcast happens, how to get podcasts to your listening device of choice, and how to host a podcast yourself, ending up with a few places online that offer podcast feeds you can visit to sample the experience and, later on, to let the world know, hey, I've got a podcast too. Part 1 also helps you pick out the best hardware and software you need to start podcasting. Part 2. The hills are alive with the sound of podcasting. Consider this part of the book Inside the Actor's Studio, part DIY Network, and part WKRP, with your host, Dr. Johnny Fever Booga. This is where we offer some techniques the pros use in broadcasting. Podcasting may be the grassroots movement of homespun telecommunications, but that doesn't mean it has to sound that way. Unless, of course, you want it to sound that way. From pre-show prep to setting your volume levels to the basics of audio editing, this is the part that polishes your podcast. Part 3. So, you've got this great recording of your voice. Now what? The audio file you've just created is now silently staring at you from your monitor. Unless you're listening to it on your computer's music player, in which case it's just defiantly talking back at you, and you haven't a clue what your next step is. We cover the last-minute details and then walk you through the process of getting your podcast online, finding the right web hosting packages for podcasts, and putting together show notes to give listeners a glance at what your latest episode is all about. Part 4. Start spreading the news about your podcast. You have your podcast recorded, edited, and online, but now you need to let people know you have this great podcast just waiting for them. And that's what we explore in Part 4. With the power of publicity, from free-of-charge word of mouth, arguably the most effective, to investment in social media, you have a wide array of options to choose from when you're ready to announce your presence to the podcasting community. Part 5. Possibilities to consider for your show. The question of why one should podcast is as important as how to podcast. We cover some basic rationales that many folks have for sitting behind a microphone, pouring heart, soul, and pocket change into their craft each and every day, week, or month. We then look ahead to streaming on Twitch or YouTube as a possible interactive addition to your podcast's workflow. Part 6. The Part of Tens. Perhaps the toughest chapters to write were these, the For Dummies trademark Part of Tens chapters. So don't skip them, because we'll be uber miffed if you fail to appreciate how hard we busted our humps to get these chapters done. Right, so what do we give you in our Part of Tens? Along with giving you 10 reasons why podcasting is something important to do, we also offer suggestions for what's out there, how they sound, and how you can benefit from them. Finally, we close with words of wisdom from some of the podcasters who have been podcasting the longest. Read, and then you decide. Author's note. Keep in mind, the podcasts we cover here are currently active at the time of writing this edition. Some of these podcasts may thrive and continue producing killer content. Some may disappear like ill-fated voyagers attempting the Bermuda Triangle. Remember this, as you might find a podcast in this book that's no longer podcasting. Icons used in this book, which will be verbalized in the audiobook format. So you're trekking through the book, making some real progress with developing your podcast, when suddenly these little icons leap out, grab you by the throat, and wrestle you to the ground. Who would have thought podcasting was so action-packed like an MCU movie, huh? What do all these little drawings mean? Glad you asked. Tip. When we're in the middle of a discussion and suddenly we have one of those, "Say, that reminds me," moments, we give you one of these tips. They're handy little extras that are good to know and might even make your podcast sound a little tighter than average. Remember, if the moment is more than a handy little nugget of information and closer to a, "Seriously, you can't forget this part," factoid, we mark it with a remember icon. You're going to want to pay close attention to these puppies. Warning. Sometimes we interrupt our train of thought with a "time out, Sparky" moment, and this is where we ask for your completely undivided attention. The warnings are exactly that. Flashing lights, auga horns, dire portents, or your local DM saying, "Roll for initiative." They're reminders not to try this at home, because you'll definitely regret it. Technical stuff. These icons illuminate the "so how does this widget really work" moments you may have as you read this book. The technical stuff icons give you a deeper understanding of what the wizard is doing behind the curtain, making you all the more apt as a podcaster. But if you want to skip the nitty-gritty details, that's perfectly fine too. Beyond the book. In addition to what you're reading right now, this product also comes with a free online cheat sheet that offers up quick reference points you'll want to have on hand when you're working on your first podcast or your first production on location. You need a quick answer at a glance? The cheat sheet should jog a memory or two from this book. To get this cheat sheet, simply go to dummies.com and search for Podcasting for Dummies cheat sheet in the search box. This book also comes with a companion podcast. Go to podcastingfordummies.com and follow the instructions to get free weekly audio commentary from T. Morris and Chuck Tomasi about concepts from this book explored in greater detail, from the difference between good and bad edits, when too much reverb is too much, and the variety of methods you can use to record a podcast. Where to go from here? At this point, many For Dummies authors say something snappy, clever, or even a bit snarky. We save our best tongue-in-cheek material for later, so here's a more serious approach. We suggest heading to where you're planning to record your podcast, or just plant yourself in front of a computer, and start with Chapter 1, where you're given a few links to check out, some suggestions on applications for downloading podcasts, and directories to look up where you can find T's and Chuck's many podcasts, and other podcasts that can educate, inspire, and enlighten your ears with original content. Where do we go from here? Up and out, my friends. Up and out. Part 1. Podcasting on a worldwide frequency. In this part, understand the fundamentals of creating, uploading, and distributing your podcast for others to enjoy. Explore various podcast directories to find content that interests you, and compare and contrast how others produce their shows. Find the right hardware, software, and accessories to fit your budget. Take your podcast recording on the road with mobile devices and processes. Chapter 1. Getting the Scoop on Podcasting. In this chapter, finding out what podcasting is, creating a podcast, finding and subscribing to podcasts. Sometimes the invention that makes the biggest impact on our daily lives isn't an invention at all, but the convergence of existing technologies, processes, and ideas. Podcasting may be the perfect example of that principle, and is changing the relationship people have with their radios, music collections, books, education, and more. The podcasting movement is actually a spin-off of another communications boom, blogs. Blogs sprang up right and left in the early 2000s, providing non-programmers and designers a clean, elegant interface that left many on the technology side wondering why they hadn't thought of it sooner. Everyday people could chronicle their lives, hopes, dreams, and fears, and show them to anyone who cared to read it. And oddly enough, people did care to read, and still do. Then, in 2003, former MTV VJ Adam Curry started collaborating with programmer David Weiner about improving RSS, which stands for Really Simple Syndication, that not only allowed you to share text and images, but media attachments, which included compressed audio and video files. Soon after, Curry released his first podcast-catching client, thus launched the media platform of podcasting. Podcasting combines the instant information exchange of blogging with audio and video files that you can play on a computer or portable media device. When you make your podcast publicly available on the internet, you are exposing your craft to anyone with a computer or mobile device and a connection capable of streaming data. To put that in perspective, some online sources report the global online population is over 4.5 billion users. In the U.S. alone, more than 275 million people own some kind of mobile device or portable media player, and every one of them is capable of playing your content. This chapter is for the consumers of the content, the audience, and those who make the content, the podcasters alike. We cover the basic steps to record a podcast and lay out the basics of what you need to do to enjoy a podcast on your media player. If you're starting to get the idea that podcasting is revolutionary, groundbreaking, and possibly a major component of social upheaval? Great. Truth is, some have made their marks in society. Some storytellers have reignited the desire for short stories, anthologies, and storytelling. Other podcasts have shone spotlights on criminal injustices. But not all podcasts are so deep. In fact, many of them are passion projects inviting you to join in on the experience. Deciding whether podcasting is for you. Technically speaking, podcasting is the distribution of specifically encoded multimedia content to subscribed personal computers via the RSS 2.0 protocol. Whew! Allows to translate that into common speak. Podcasting allows you to listen to what you want, where you want, when you want. Podcasting turns the tables on broadcast schedules, allowing the listener to choose not only what to listen to, but also when. Often referred to as time-shifted media. And because podcasts are transferred via the internet, the power to create an audio program isn't limited to those with access to a radio transmitter. The simplest reason to podcast is that it's just plain fun. We've been podcasting since the beginning, and we're still having a blast, continuing to get out messages to our worldwide audiences and challenging ourselves with new tricks and techniques in creating captivating media. So, yeah, for the fun of it, heck of a good reason. The following sections cover other reasons podcasting is probably for you. What's in a name when the name is podcasting? As with most items that make their way into the conversational lexicon of speech, the precise origins and meaning behind podcasting are somewhat clouded. Although the domain podcast.com was originally registered back in 2002, nothing was ever done with it as far as we know, and Ben Hammersley suggested that and many other terms in February 2004. guardian.co.uk/media/2004/feb/12/broadcasting.digitalmedia. It's generally accepted in the podcast community that the first person to use the term as a reference to the activity we now know as podcasting was Danny Gregoire on September 15, 2004. Some voices in tech asserted the name held connotations to Apple's popular player of the time, the iPod. Regardless of the intentions, the term was backronymed, that is, treated like an acronym and applied to a variety of plausible existing meanings, even with alternative names defiantly offered, but to no avail. The term podcasting became part of everyday lexicon. Since 2004, though, content creators who set up YouTube and Twitch live streams and tell the world, "Check out my podcast," garnered weeping and gnashing of teeth by your authors. We've been what you would call purists, telling people, "You can't call it a podcast if you don't have an RSS feed." However, on finding our own place in streaming, we understood that times change, technology evolves, and even these old dogs can learn new tricks. The term podcast no longer represents the specific technology linked to RSS, but is more about making your content available to a global audience automatically delivered or streaming on demand. For that reason, we include Chapter 17 to help get you started streaming and seamlessly work it into your podcast's workflow. You want to deliver media on a regular basis. Sure, you can include audio, video, and PDFs content in your blog if you have one. Many bloggers create special content and insert them as links into the text of their blog posts. Readers then download the files at their leisure. However, this approach requires manual selection of the content blog hosts want readers to download. What sets podcasting apart from blogging is that podcasting automates that process. A listener who subscribes to your podcast is subscribed to all your content whenever it's available. No need to go back to the site to see what's new. Once you subscribe to a podcast, the content is delivered to you in the same way as when you subscribe to a print magazine. New content, delivered to you. See what we did there? You want to reach beyond the boundaries of broadcast media. In radio, unless it is satellite radio, the number of people who can listen to a show is limited by the power of the transmitter pumping out the signal. Same thing with broadcast television, depending on whether you are using antenna, cable, or satellite dish to receive programming. Podcasting doesn't rely on or utilize signals, transmitters, or receivers, at least not in the classic sense. Podcasts use the internet as a delivery system, opening up a potential audience that could extend to the entire planet. No rules exist, yet anyway, to regulate the creation of podcast content. In fact, neither the FCC nor any other regulatory body for any other government holds jurisdiction over podcasts. If that seems astounding, remember that podcasters are not using the public airwaves to deliver the message. Warning. Just because the FCC doesn't have jurisdiction, you're not exempt from the law or, perhaps more important, immune to lawsuits. You're personally responsible for anything you say, do, or condone on your show. Additionally, the rules concerning airplay of licensed music, the distribution of copyrighted material, and the legalities of recording conversations all apply. Pay close attention to the relevant sections in Chapter 5 to avoid some serious consequences. When it comes to the legalities, ignorance is not bliss. You have something to say. As a general rule, podcasters produce content that likely holds appeal for only a select audience. Podcasts start with an idea, something that you have the desire and knowledge, either real or imaginary, to talk about. Add to that a bit of drive, do-it-yourself-ishness, and an inability to take no for an answer. The point is to say what you want to say to those who want to hear it. Podcasts can be about anything and be enjoyed by just about anyone. The topics covered don't have to be earth-shattering or life-changing. They can be about do-it-yourself projects, sound-seeing tours of places you visit, or even your favorite board games. A few rules and guidelines are common in practice, but at times you may find it necessary to bend the rules. That can be a lot of fun in itself. Some of the most popular podcasts are created by everyday people who sit in front of their computers for a few nights a week and just speak their minds, hearts, and souls. Some are focused on niche topics. Others are more broad-based. You want to hear from your listeners. Something that is a real perk with podcasting, accessibility. On average, most audiences have a direct line of contact between themselves and the podcast's host or hosts. Podcast consumers are more likely to provide feedback for what they listen or watch, probably traceable to the personal nature of a podcast. Unlike popular talk shows that follow strict formulaic approaches, podcasts offer their audiences and the creators behind the production control, options, and intimacy traditional broadcast media cannot. It is that appeal that attracted major production studios like NPR, ESPN, Disney, HBO, and many others to podcasting. The connection of podcasting with audiences would pave the way for streamers, and now podcasting and streaming are synonymous with one another. Remember, when you ask for feedback, you're likely to get it, and from unusual places. Because geography doesn't limit the distance your podcast can travel, you may find yourself with listeners in faraway and exotic places. And this feedback isn't always going to be, "Wow, great podcast!" Listeners will be honest with you when you invite feedback. Creating a podcast. There are two schools of thought when it comes to creating a podcast. The, "I need the latest and greatest equipment in order to capture that crisp, clear sound of the broadcasting industry" school of thought. And the, "Hey, my laptop has a built-in microphone, and I've got this cool recording software already installed" school of thought. Both are equally valid positions, and there are a lot of secondary schools in between. The question is how far you're willing to go. But allow us to dispel a few misconceptions about podcasting right off the bat. You're not reprogramming your operating system. You're not hacking into the Internal Revenue Service's database. And you're not setting up a wireless computer network with tinfoil from a chewing gum wrapper, a shoestring, and your belt, regardless if MacGyver showed you how. Podcasting is not rocket science. In fact, here's a quick rundown of how you podcast. 1. Record audio or video and convert it to a download-friendly format. 2. Write a description of what it is that you just created as a blog post. 3. Upload everything to a host server. Yes, yes, yes. If podcasting were that simple, then why is this book so thick? Well, we admit that this list does gloss over a few details, but a podcast, in its most streamlined raw presentation, is that simple. The details of putting together a single episode start in Chapter 2 and wrap up in Chapter 8. Then Chapters 9, 10, 11, and 12 walk you through all you need to make the media you create into a podcast. So, yeah, podcasting is easy, but there's a lot to it. Looking for the bare necessities. You need a few things before starting your first podcast, many of which you can probably find on your own computer. For these beginning steps, we focus on audio. Here's what you should keep an eye on. Technical stuff. A microphone. Take a look at your computer. Right now, regardless of whether you have a laptop or desktop model, Windows or Macintosh, your computer probably has a microphone built into it, or a USB port for plugging in a microphone. Yes, even your mobile phone has a microphone, or it wouldn't be much of a phone, now would it? Many earbuds even include a microphone. Position the microphone in a comfortable spot on your desk or table. If you're using a laptop, it should be somewhere on your desk that allows for best recording results without hunching over the computer like young Frankenstein's Igor. Check the laptop's documentation to find out where the built-in microphone is located in the unit's housing. For the mobile phone, hold the device as if you are making a call, the way it was intended. Holding the device any other way can degrade the audio quality. If you are using the microphone earbud set included with the phone's purchase, you may need to do some experimentation. Usually the built-in microphone in a laptop is located close to the edge of the keyboard or near the laptop speakers. Some models tuck it in at the center point of the monitor's base. Recording software. Check out the software that came with your computer. You know, all those extra applications that you filed away, thinking, "I'll check those out sometime." Well, the time has arrived to flip through them. You probably have some sort of audio recording software loaded on your computer, such as Voice Recorder, PC, or GarageBand, which comes pre-installed with new Macs. Tip: if you don't already have the appropriate software, here's a fast way to get it. Download the version of Audacity that fits your operating system at audacityteam.org. Oh yeah, it's free. An audio interface. Make sure your computer has the hardware it needs to handle audio recording and the drivers to run the hardware. Unless, of course, you have a built-in microphone. Tip: Some desktop computers come with a very elementary audio card built into the motherboard. Before you run out to your local computer vendor and spring for an audio card, check your computer to see whether it can already handle basic voice recording. For tips on choosing the right mic and audio accessories, be sure to listen carefully to Chapter 2. Chapter 3 covers all the software you need. Recording your first podcast. When you have your computer set up and your microphone working, it's time to start recording. Take a deep breath and then follow these steps. 1. Jot down a few notes on what you want to talk about. Nothing too fancy. Just make an outline that includes remarks about who you are and what you want to talk about. Use these bullet points to keep yourself on track. All this, checking your computer, jotting down notes, and setting up your recording area, is called pre-show prep, discussed in depth in Chapter 5 by other podcasters who have their own set ways of getting ready to record. 2. Click the record button in your recording software and go for as long as it takes for you to get through your notes. Tip: we recommend keeping your first recording to no more than 20 minutes. That may seem like a lot of time, but it will fly by. 3. Give a nice little sign-off, like, "Take care of yourselves, see you next time," and click the stop button. 4. Choose File, Save As, and give your project a name. Now bask in the warmth of creative accomplishment. Compressing your audio files. Portable media devices and computers can play MP3 files as a default format. While there are many other audio formats in existence, MP3 is the preferred format for podcasting because so many digital devices and operating systems recognize it. If your recording software can output straight to MP3 format, your life is much simpler. If your software cannot export directly to MP3, it should be able to save to a WAV, Windows, or AIFF, Mac file, which are raw, uncompressed, and can get rather large. In this case, save your raw file from your first software package and then use Audacity to import the file and export it as MP3. We get into those details in Chapter 3. Congratulations! You just recorded your first audio podcast. Easy, isn't it? This is merely the first step into a larger world, as Obi-Wan once told Luke. Uploading your audio to the web. An audio file sitting on your desktop, regardless of how earth-shattering the contents may be, is not a podcast. Nope, not by a long shot. You have to get it up on the internet and provide a way for listeners to grab that tasty file for later consumption. If you already have a web server for your blog, company website, or personal website, this process can be as easy as creating a new folder and transferring your newly created audio file to your server. If that last paragraph left you puzzled and you're wondering what kind of mess you've gotten yourself into, relax. We don't leave you hanging out in the wind. Chapter 10 covers everything you need to know about choosing a web host for your podcast media files. Technical stuff. A podcast media file can be any sort of media file you like: audio, video, or even an interactive PDF. While our primary attention is on audio, you can use all the tips we give here to handle other types of media. After you upload your episode, you need to have an RSS, really simple syndication file generated to deliver it. That happens automatically on a blog. The RSS describes where to find the media file you just uploaded. Nearly all software for blogging, called blog engines, support RSS, but not all support podcasts. You may need to add a plugin, a downloadable extension that makes podcast support a simple affair. This generated RSS file is your podcast feed. People who listen to your podcast can subscribe to your show by placing a link to this podcast feed in the podcast application, such as Apple's Podcast, Overcast, Stitcher, and Spotify. All these apps are looking for your podcast's RSS and list it in their directory, which is exactly what it sounds like, a digital catalog of podcasts that are available to you. Yes, we know, this all sounds really complicated, but we assure you it's not. Some hosting companies, such as Libsyn.com, specialize in taking the technological bite out of podcasting so that you can focus on creating your best-sounding show. With Libsyn, moving your file to a web server is as simple as pushing a few buttons, While the creation of the RSS 2.0 podcast feed and even the accompanying webpage are automatic. If you want to take more control over your website, podcast media files, and their corresponding RSS 2.0 feed, listen to chapters 9 and 10. In those pages, we walk you through some essentials. Not only how to upload a file, but also how to easily generate your RSS 2.0 file using a variety of tools. Grabbing listeners. With media files in place and an RSS 2.0 feed ready to be recognized by your podcast app of choice, you're officially a podcaster. Of course, that doesn't mean a lot if you're the only person who knows about your podcast. You need to spread the word to let others know that you exist and that you have something pretty darned important to say. Creating show notes. Before you pick up a bullhorn, slap a sandwich board over yourself, and start walking down the street, virtually, anyway, you have to make sure you're descriptive enough to captivate those who reach your website. First, you're going to want to describe the contents of your show to casual online passersby in hopes of getting them to listen to what you have to say. That blog post you created to help deliver your media is that place. This is where show notes take form and give people a rundown of what you're talking about. Remember, you can easily glance at a blog and get the gist of a conversation, but an audio file requires active listening to understand. In effect, you're asking people to make an investment of their time in listening to you talk, read a story, or play music. You need some compelling text on a web page to hook them. Show notes are designed to quickly showcase or highlight the relevant and pertinent contents of the audio file itself. A verbatim transcript of your show isn't always necessary, but we do recommend more than simply saying, "A show about my day." Chapter 11 discusses ways to create your show notes and offer tips and tricks to give them some punch. Getting listed in directories. When you have a final media file and a solid set of show notes, you're ready to take your podcast message to the masses. You can get listed on some directories and podcast listing sites, such as Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, and Blueberry, explained later in this chapter. Potential listeners visit literally dozens of websites as they seek out new content, and getting yourself listed on as many as possible can help bring in more new listeners to your program. Warning: a huge listener base is a double-edged sword. More demand for your product means more of a demand on you and the resources necessary to keep your podcast up and running. We recommend working on your craft and your skills, as well as getting a good handle on the personal and technological requirements of podcasting before you embark on a huge marketing campaign. When you're ready, Part 4 has more details about marketing. Part 4 spends a lot of time talking about the various ways you can attract more listeners to your show and ways to respond to the ideas and feedback that your listeners inevitably provide. Many podcasters are surprised at the sheer volume of comments they receive from their listeners. But when you consider how personal podcasting is, compared to traditional forms of media distribution, that's really not surprising at all. There's an app for that. You have the media file, an RSS feed, and accompanying show notes. You're all set, but ask yourself, how do podcasts get from the web to my device so I can watch or listen? To access all this great new content, you need a podcatcher, an application that looks at various RSS feeds, finds the new stuff, and transfers it from the internet to your computer or mobile device automatically. In this section, we take a look at some of the different podcatching apps available for your listening or viewing needs. Remember, you may think you need an iPod for all kinds of reasons, but you really don't need one to podcast. Allow us to state that again. You do not need an iPod to listen to or create a podcast. You don't even need an iPhone to listen to or create a podcast either. The only I you need is yourself. As long as you have an MP3 player, be it an application on a Mac, an application on a PC, mobile phone, or any portable device you can unplug and take with you, you possess the capability to listen to podcasts. Depending on the MP3 player, you may even be able to create your podcast on the device as well. But to listen, all you need is a device that can play audio files. This includes your computer. The following sections represent only a starting point for getting access to podcasts. Any attempt at a comprehensive list would be instantly obsolete. Podcasting continues to grow in popularity, and new podcasting apps are coming out all the time. And remember, you can listen to podcasts on all sorts of devices besides computers: smartphones, tablets, Apple TV, Roku, and more. The Old Timer, Apple Podcasts. With iTunes launching its own podcast directory and a podcast-ready version of its player in June 2005, podcasting went from what the geeks were doing in the basement of the science building to the next wave of innovation on the internet, which was, of course, developed by the geeks in the basement of the science building. Plenty of contributing factors helped push podcasting mainstream, but iTunes introducing a push-button subscription method was a huge step forward. As always, such a step into the mainstream market brought some dismay to the original podcasters, finding themselves overshadowed by larger media entities. Now, recognizable giants like NPR, The New York Times, ESPN, BBC, and so on dominate Apple's podcast directory. What about the indie podcasts, the ones that started it all? Would they be forgotten, go unnoticed, languish unsubscribed? Well, at first it seemed that many of the original groundbreakers that the podcasting community knew and loved, Comedy for Cast, Evil Genius Chronicles, Cover Girl, Grammar Girl, might get lost in the stampede. But not yet, as it turns out. If you go looking for iTunes on your Mac and cannot find it, it could be that you have upgraded to Catalina, or later. The monolithic iTunes app has been replaced with a separate podcasts app, along with another for music and a third for shows and movies. As for the Windows edition, fear not, as of this writing you can still get iTunes for Windows, available for download at apple.com/iTunes. Whether using Apple Podcasts or iTunes on your desktop, the software lends an automatic hand to people new to podcasting, where to find blogs that host podcasts, and which podcast directories list the shows that fit their needs and desires. Now they, too, can enjoy a wide range of podcast choices. Subscribing to podcasts using Apple Podcasts is easy. Just follow these steps. 1. Find the podcast of your choice. You can do that by browsing the list of podcasts from the Browse option on the left side, viewing the popular podcasts by using top charts below that, searching by using the search box in the upper left. 2. When you find a show that you are interested in, click the image to get the podcast page, and then click the subscribe button. After your podcast finishes downloading, you can find the new episodes by going to the Listen Now section in the left column of podcasts, or get specific shows or episodes from your library, also on the left. Podcasting on the go. Stitcher. As smartphones and tablets become more and more prevalent, the notion of having an app for that grew in demand. Finding and subscribing to podcasts in the early days was possible on a mobile device, but a bit clunky. The stage had been set for a new kind of interface that was just as easy and elegant to use on your mobile device as it would be on a computer. Enter Stitcher. Stitcher Radio. Stitcher.com, with an app available for both iPhone and Android, debuted in 2008 and has quickly become a must-have for not only podcasts, but for radio shows coast-to-coast and around the world. On the app or on their computer, members of the Stitcher community stitch together on-air feeds from radio stations and podcasts, both from professional and amateur studios, into personalized stations all readily available on your mobile devices. Once you set up a free user account on Stitcher, finding a podcast for your personal feed is only a few taps away. 1. Launch Stitcher on your mobile device. 2. Sign in with either Facebook, Google, or your Stitcher account. 3. Find the podcast of your choice. You can do that by tapping on the search icon in the bottom right corner, swiping up through the offered feeds on your front page. The more you use Stitcher, the more shows matching your interests will appear here. 4. When you find something you like, tap the show's image. 5. To subscribe, tap the plus sign just below the show's image. The show appears in your favorites list. Click the play icon next to any episode to listen right now. Stitcher is not only a terrific option for podcast audiences, as the service is available on a variety of platforms, including playback through your browser, but Stitcher also interfaces seamlessly with many makes and models of automobiles. Plugging your smartphone into your car's USB port is immediately recognized, and your car's media center immediately picks up where you left off. Welcome the game changer, Overcast. When it came to Apple and podcasting, the early days of the Apple Podcasts app were a bit tumultuous. Playback was awkward, interfaces were less than intuitive, and crashing was not uncommon. In 2013, developer Marco Armand introduced a modest app designed for subscribing and listening to podcasts at the XOXO Festival. Ironically, he unveiled the app during a talk on competition and the risks and benefits of how crowded the creative field had become. It's ironic as this app, Overcast, Overcast.fm, received rave reviews with The Verge and The Sweet Setup calling it the best podcast app for iOS for many years. Along with its stability, Overcast offers what podcasting apps of that time lacked: simplicity. Subscribed podcasts were listed alphabetically. Going into a podcast, episodes could be listed by unplayed episodes or all episodes available. The settings for the app and even the podcast itself could be controlled from the app. You can also play episodes back faster or slower than their original speed, and you can pick up from where you leave off. Once you set up your free account and download the app, finding a podcast for your personal feed is only a few taps away. 1. Download and launch Overcast on your mobile device. 2. Sign in with your account. 3. Find the podcast of your choice. You can do that by tapping on the search directory field across the top, scanning the various podcasts offered in Overcast's categories, adding a podcast's URL manually by tapping the Add URL option into the top right corner. 4. When you find something you want to know more about, tap the podcast. 5. Once you find a podcast you want to listen to, tap the subscribe button. Armand kept things simple in this app's UI, short for user interface, and created an elegant interface that makes Overcast a must-have for those on the iOS platform, even with Apple Podcasts available everywhere. Podcasting with a G-Man, Google Play Music. Not to be outdone by Apple and the iOS developers, the diversified search engine service Google, the people who bring you Google Drive, Google Docs, and Google Voice, which we discuss later on, offers Google Play Music, play.google.com/store, for Android users. It is exactly as it sounds. Google's version of the Apple iTunes, before the breakup, all in one. Google Play works with the Google Play Music app to bring podcasts to you in the same way as Stitcher and Apple Podcasts. A few extra steps are involved in getting podcasts subscribed and playing on your phone. Once you download Google Play Music and sync it up with your Google account, 1. Launch Google Play Music on your mobile device and then tap on the menu option in the top left of the app screen. 2. Select podcasts from the options. 3. Find the podcast of your choice. You can do that by tapping on the search icon in the top right corner side, tapping on the All Categories option to reveal the top-rated podcasts of categories and subcategories of interest, swiping through the top charts, podcasts that are either promoted or popular. This is the main page of Google Play Music's podcasts directory. 4. When you find the podcast you want to listen to, click the subscribe button. Google Play Music offers a series of options for you to complete before subscribing. Select auto-download if you want the latest content to update automatically. Opt in for a push notification when new content downloads. Select a playback order if you want podcast episodes to go from oldest to newest or newest to oldest. 5. Choose your option and tap subscribe again. Google Play Music's UI is targeted mainly towards music, although with podcasts, it gets the job done. Granted, if your loyalties are not to one operating system, Spotify works with both iOS and Android users. Regardless of which app best suits you and your digital lifestyle, it's good to know options are out there and available for you. A new 800-pound gorilla, Spotify. For nearly a decade, the king of podcasting apps was Apple iTunes. But like all technology, the crown must get passed. When you say Spotify, most people will think of streaming music. But in 2015, it added support for podcasts. It was exclusively set aside for music artists and broadcast media productions. And in 2018, Spotify simplified its application and screening process, and now brings podcasting to millions of listeners worldwide. The desktop app requires you to make a download from Spotify's site, Spotify.com. Once installed, log in or create a free account. 1. Use the search box in the top left to enter a podcast name or click Browse on the left and select Podcasts. 2. When you find a podcast you like, take one of the following actions. Click the play icon to listen immediately. Click the heart icon to save it to your library. Use the three-dot menu and choose Follow. This is Spotify's way of subscribing to a podcast. Now you can quickly find the podcast you follow by clicking Podcasts on the left under your library. The Spotify mobile experience is very similar. 1. After signing in, tap Search on the bottom to search and browse podcasts. 2. Tap the Follow button or listen to an episode directly from the list. 3. Followed podcasts are available from your library at the bottom of the screen and tapping Podcasts in big letters at the top. To listen anywhere, click the down arrow on any episode, and it will be available in your downloads list under Podcasts. Warning: at the time of this writing, Spotify only approves audio podcast feeds for its directories. Any episodes that are offering other forms of media will be rejected. In order to get your feed approved for Spotify, you will need to assure that all your episodes are audio. You can still have posts on your blog featuring embedded videos and special downloads, but you will not be able to use the RSS feed as a delivery method. Other podcast resources. It goes without saying that this book is a snapshot in time, and you will likely want to keep up on the latest news and information of the podcasting world. There are plenty of resources online and in MeetSpace, real live human beings, where you can ask questions and exchange information. A quick search of LinkedIn, Meetup.com, Facebook, and yes, even Google can reveal a wealth of resources after you're done reading this book and listening to our podcast. Chapter 2: Getting the Gadgets to Produce a Podcast. In this chapter, choosing the microphone that's best for you, getting the right mixing board, accessorizing your studio. Now that you're effectively hip as to what podcasting is and what it's all about, you need to start building your studio. This studio can come in a variety of shapes, sizes, and price tags. What you're thinking about doing, podcasting in this case, is like any hobby you pursue. If it's something to pass the time, then keep your setup simple. A modest setup with little to no investment is ideal if you want to see whether you like playing with audio. If, on the other hand, you find yourself tapping into a hidden passion or, even better, a hidden talent, you might want to upgrade to the audio gear that's bigger, better, and badder than the basics. If you suddenly decide you, yes you, have a message you want to share, your next plan of action will be one of two options: picking up a digital recorder, reading the instruction manual, and then downloading some free audio editing software, or watching the DIY network for methods of soundproofing the basement and looking at industry standard equipment that might require some extra homework to master. This is the beauty of podcasting. In the long run, it doesn't matter whether your podcasting studio is a smartphone with a plug-in microphone or comprised of the latest mixing boards, audio software, and recording equipment. Both approaches to podcasting work and are successfully implemented on a variety of podcasts. So, which one works best for what you have in mind? That's what we take a look at in this chapter, discussing the options, advantages, and disadvantages of each setup. Finding the right mic. It's easy and affordable to make your computer podcast capable. Your first order of business is to find the right mic. If you already have a microphone built into your laptop, and you don't mind starting out basic, you can just download Audacity, described in Chapter 3, and take advantage of the fact that it's free. That's all there is to it. At least for starters, anyway. However, if your desktop computer didn't come with a mic, or you're just not happy podcasting Quasimodo style, you're going to want to shop around. While microphone shopping, consider the following criteria. What's your price range? In many cases, especially with cheap mics, you get what you pay for in quality of construction and range of capabilities. You want the most affordable model of microphone that will do the job for you and your podcast. Do you plan to use the mic primarily in the studio or on location? A high-end shock-mounted model isn't the best choice for a walk in the park, and a lapel mic might not provide you with the quality of sound expected for an in-studio podcast. Before you purchase your mic, consider your podcasting location needs. Remember, There are many different types of microphones and microphone connections, or jacks. Some mics are built to plug into mixers, while others connect directly to your computer's USB port. If you're thinking of starting with an inexpensive mic, you may not be able to plug it into your upgraded rig later on. Similarly, if you're upgrading to an XLR microphone, described later in this chapter, you may find yourself upgrading more than just your mic. What do you want this mic to do? Pick up sound? Yeah, okay, but what kind and in what surroundings? Some mics offer ease of handling for interviews. Some are good at snagging specific outdoor sounds. Others may be better at capturing live music. You need to consider multi-purpose mics, guest mics, and on-location recording devices or any kind of condition your podcast may require. Even after narrowing your options, there are so many microphones on the market. After a while, the manufacturers, makes, and models all start to give you that kind of brain freeze you get when you eat ice cream too quickly. The sections that follow give you the lowdown on the mic that's right for your budget, and even make a few sound recommendations along the way. Sound recommendations. Dad humor. Tip. Say, did you know there's a companion podcast for this book? Yeah, it's Podcasting for Dummies, the companion podcast. In Season 4, T and Chuck talk at length about microphones, including testing several makes and models, comparing and contrasting the sound of each. To find out more about microphones, gadgets, and concepts, listen to Podcasting for Dummies, the companion podcast, available at podcastingfordummies.com. A Beginner's Guide to Mics. The microphone market, over the years, has seen the universal serial bus, USB, microphone go from trendy tech gimmick to state-of-the-art innovation, changing the way we record audio. With more than 15 years of development, one consistency has been the setup of these microphones. Plug it in and start recording. That's it. You can go online to any of the computer equipment retailers and type USB microphones in their respective search engines. Make sure you include USB, because a search for microphones can bring up many more alternatives, including video cameras, high-end mics, which we talk about next, and other devices that may be way out of your budget. Remember, you don't have to sacrifice your retirement fund to get started with a USB microphone. Prices start under $20 for a simple desktop microphone. The phrase, "you get what you pay for," doesn't always apply in podcasting either. We've heard some pretty amazing sounds out of inexpensive microphones. Warning. Built-in microphones and many of the cheaper mics are in physical contact with a desk or table in front of you, which means they pick up vibrations. Any noise on the surface, such as setting down a glass or drumming fingers, is going to be amplified in the microphone and recorded. Pay attention to the accessorize section later in this chapter, where we talk about mic stands to help reduce this issue. You can find USB microphones online starting as low as $10. For a few dollars more, you can invest in a gaming headset like the Logitech G Pro 10. The Pro 10 headset, priced at $130, is a standout among other gaming headsets as its mic uses the same technology found in Blue microphones. BlueDesigns.com, a pioneer in USB microphone development. This headset provides podcasters with a simple, single-purchase solution offering exceptional audio quality in the headphones, coupled with clean, clear pickups only found in Blue mics. One advantage headsets hold over a desktop microphone is that your mouth is always the same distance away from the actual part of the microphone that picks up sound. If you're an animated podcaster, like your authors, this may be useful. On the other hand, headsets can be very sensitive to breathing sounds. If the headset's mic boom is in the wrong position, the slightest breath from your mouth or nose will sound like an EF5 tornado passing by. Remember, although purchasing a USB headset is a monetary plus because you're getting both headphones and mic together with one purchase, this isn't all you need to monitor yourself as you record. To self-monitor your recording, you need software that offers you an on-screen mixer, a mixing board, or the option to monitor the incoming audio signal. Once you plug in your mic or your headset into a USB port and set up your audio preferences in your recording software, you're ready for recording. Warning. While USB microphones are quick and easy to set up, there's no real good way to connect more than one to a computer at a time. If you're planning to have your best friend as a co-host or have an in-studio interview guest, then consider microphones that connect to a mixing board. Investing in a high-end mic. So you can go cheap and pick up a microphone for as little as $10. But let's be honest here. You're going to sound like you've been recorded by a $10 microphone. Say, however, you really want that sharp, professional sound for your podcast, and the cheaper microphones just aren't cutting it for you. As you shop for an upgrade, you see mics ranging in price from an inexpensive $70 and reaching up to $20,000. No, you're not seeing a typo involving a couple extra zeros. What defines a microphone? Price? Manufacturer? Look? What truly defines a microphone is how you sound on it and how it reproduces the sound coming in. Prices vary on microphones based on how they work. Plenty of high-quality microphones out there can pick up nuances and details and still remain in the range of affordability. Warning: when you purchase a higher-end microphone, keep in mind that you probably will not receive cables for hookup, a jack that fits into your computer, or a stand. That's because you're upgrading to professional equipment. The manufacturer is offering you the flexibility to have different bells and whistles, the whatchamajigs, and extra doodads to make this mic work. For the lowdown on what accessories you need to hook up your new mic to your computer, pay close attention to the accessorize section later in this chapter. Remember those three questions a few minutes back? Question number 2, do you plan to use the mic primarily in the studio or on location? Helps narrow your search even more for the microphone that's the right investment for you. At this level, there are two kinds of mics you will hear people talk about: dynamic and condenser mics. Dynamic mics. Dynamic mics are what you see everywhere, from speaking engagements to rock concerts. In fact, when someone mentions the word microphone, the image that comes to mind is probably a dynamic microphone. These mics work like a speaker in reverse. Sound entering a dynamic mic by speaking directly into it vibrates a diaphragm, a small plate attached to a coil. This is located within proximity of a magnet, and the vibrations that this wily coyote setup makes create a small electric current. When this signal runs through a preamp or mixer, the original sound is recreated. This system sounds complicated, and if you've ever looked inside of a microphone, it is. But the internal makeup of dynamic microphones is such that they can take a lot of incoming signal and still produce audio clearly. They're also rugged in build, so they can be manhandled, making dynamic mics exceptional for outdoor recording. If you're working in studio, consider working with Shoales SM7B. This mic offers up a clean, rich sound and picks up incredible details for a dynamic microphone. For microphones you may want to use out in the field, the Rode Reporter, rode.com/microphones/reporter, is specifically designed for handheld interviews and delivers broadcast quality results within any environment. Condenser mics. When podcasting happens in studio and you're looking for the subtleties and nuances of the human voice in your recording, the more detail you get, the better. You may want to shop for studio condenser microphones. The anatomy of a condenser microphone is similar to a dynamic one. In the condenser, a diaphragm is suspended in front of a stationary plate that conducts electricity. As a signal enters the microphone, the air between the diaphragm and the plate is displaced, creating a fluctuating electrical charge. Once given a bit more power, phantom power, which is explained later in this chapter, the movement becomes an electrical representation of the incoming audio signal. This setup sounds very delicate, doesn't it? Guess what? It is. This is why condenser mics are transported in padded cases and not really built for handheld use. These microphones are best used for in-studio recordings versus on-location podcasts. If manhandled or jostled around, plates can be knocked out of alignment or damaged, causing problems in the pickups. The advantage to this delicate setup is that condenser mics are far more sensitive to sound, and they pick up a wider spectrum of audio. These microphones are so sensitive to noise around them that some come with shock mounts, spring-loaded frames that suspend the mic when attached to a microphone stand, providing better stability while reducing any noise or vibration from your microphone stand. Think of a shock mount as a shock absorber for your mic. Remember, although dynamic microphones are marketed more for on-location recording and condenser mics are considered best for in-studio recording, these aren't hard and fast rules for what mics should be used where. Sometimes podcasters use condensers in outdoor settings, and some podcasters prefer the sound of dynamic mics in studio over condensers. When picking a microphone, You want a mic that not only suits your needs, but also makes you sound good. Really good. Tip. For multi-mic podcasts in the same location, consider dynamic microphones. If you plan to have a studio with a few friends over as guests, the sensitivity of several condenser microphones can be a liability and will degrade the overall sound of your podcast. The sound from one person's voice will be picked up not only on their mic, but also on the other mics as a distant sound. Overall, it will sound like everyone is talking into a single microphone across the room, like one of those bad conference room calls with a mic in the center of the table. Very distracting to the listener. T is a big fan of MXL microphones. MXLmics.com, mentioned earlier in this chapter. His first in-studio microphone was an MXL 990, a model he still podcasts with to this day. MXL microphones, along with being affordable, reliable, and popular, often come bundled with mixer boards, discussed later in this chapter. Online vendors like BSW, bswusa.com, are offering podcast bundles featuring another MXL microphone, the BCD1, with each bundle offering new accessories. Cost and features go up, but the high-quality sound that the MXL line captures remains the same. USB Studio Condenser Mics. Microphone vendors are noting the popularity of podcasting, and now USB Studio Condenser microphones are becoming more and more prevalent. Leading this movement is the previously mentioned Blue Microphones, bluedesigns.com. After the success of the Snowball Ice, $70, in the early years of podcasting, Blue went on to develop the Yeti, $130, both reliable examples of what is now available for podcasters. Blue also offers the Yeti X, $170, an impressive audio solution for podcasters, offering mixing, gain, and metering all in one simple interface built into the microphone. The Yeti X also provides a variety of pickup patterns, making the microphone versatile in recording settings and situations. With these microphone models, podcasters can now record studio-quality audio without an additional audio card, a mixer, or any of the go-betweens once considered essential for connecting audio gear to a computer. With USB condenser microphones, the audio signal now has a direct connection to the computer. It makes your podcast production extremely portable. The phantom power of the podcast. You might notice that condenser mics, such as the MXL microphones described in this chapter, are phantom-powered. Their connection to the mixer provides them with all the power they need. Because phantom power comes from the mixing board in the studio, through the cable connecting to the mic, it supplies a constant boost. Portable condenser mics use batteries to get their kick, but when they start to die, so does your recording quality. A word to the wise, always keep fresh batteries on hand and check your mic's battery level before you record.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.